Model learning adoption from informal into formal and student and model to measure model acceptance among teachers. This communication has been elaborated in collaboration with Dr. Susana Ruiz-Miguel and Dr. Francisco José García Peñago from the University of Santa Maria. In this exposition, we are going to begin with a brief introduction to the context of the proposal. After this, we are going to describe the TAM model, its current situation and future research lines. And after this, we will focus on the application of TAM in educational context. Finally, we will present our proposal for a standard TAM model in order to measure mobile acceptance and primary education teachers. Mobile learning is a methodology that explores the uses of mobile devices into the educational context. It has been traditionally situated inside the informal context of education, mainly due to the contextual, to its character of contextual, individualized and situated learning. But the autonomy that brings to the student, joining with the communicational process power of the technologies, is leading to the education anytime, anywhere, which contributes to blur the line between formal and formal education, and it's starting to be a growing number of investigations that planned the use of mobile devices in formal learning context. Overall, we have experience in all levels that covers from mobile PLEs to pseudo paper environments, augmented reality experiences, etc. But the investigation is still in an early stage of development, and there are not always successful experiences of integration of mobile devices in formal education environments. The teachers play a key role in the integration of any technological advancement, and we consider that the TAM can be a useful tool in order to study which factors lead to this acceptance. In this session, we are going to talk about the TAM model. We will begin with the most next definition of the model, and we will cover its evolution and future lines. Mobile learning is based on the theory of reason action and the theory of brain behavior. The theory of reason action is proposed by Eisen and Fishbein and try to explain the process that leads a person to perform a given behavior. It starts with two concepts, the attitude, which is composed by the beliefs of the individual, and the subjective norm, that they define as the organization or social pressure toward performing a determined behavior perceived by the individual. These two concepts condition the behavioral intention that they define as a person's general feeling of favorableness or unfavorableness towards some stimulus object. And this behavioral intention is what conditions the actual behavior. When they tested this model in the field, they found some limitation overall regarding the voluntariness. So, Einstein made a revision of the theory of reason action and proposed the theory of brain behavior, where he added to the scheme the concept of perceived behavioral control that makes reference to the organization and social pressure toward performing a determined behavior perceived by the individual. When Davis planted his model, he wondered which elements could influence the actual use of an informational system. He proposed the concept of perceived usefulness and perceived ease of use. The perceived usefulness is the degree to which a person believes that using a particular system could enhance his or her performance, and the perceived ease of use, which is the degree to which a person believes that using a particular system would be free of effort. These two concepts influence the attitude towards using, which influences the behavioral intention with condition the actual use of a system. He also recognized the existence of several external variables that affect the perceived usefulness and the perceived ease of use, but he didn't depend on them in his original model. He built an instrument based on a Likert type scale in order to measure this content through self-reports. The main advantages of the model are its theoretical strength, the head percentage of the variance that it explains, and its simplicity. The main disadvantages are the lack of dependence in the external variables, the use of self-reports for the measure, which condition overall the report of the data on actual use, and it's encountered some problems with some exploratory studies. In order to overcome these difficulties and increase the percentage of the variance that explain the instrument, or adapt it to new construct, the technology of Theta's model has suffered, is frequently modified by another scientist. The more common modification can be classified in four groups: the inclusion of external precursors, such as the working experience or the self-efficacy, the incorporation of factors from other theories in order to increment the predictive capacity, and the introduction of contextual factors, such as gender, culture, or features of the device. The last group would be the measurement of final images. There are also two versions of the TAM. The TAM 2, which added to the scheme the subjective norm, the previous experience, and the voluntariness, and the TAM 3, which main innovation are the inclusion of anchored and adjustment factors that influence the perceived ease of use. This model is popular in the fields of commerce and ICT, and is starting to be used in other fields like education or healthcare. The main lines for the evolution of this model are the study of the individual variables, the addition of other variables from the models and this modelated factor, the study of the actual use, how to measure it more efficiently, and what is the real relationship between actual use and behavioral intention, and the application of the TAM model in FDTH. Well, now I'm going to talk about the application of TAM in educational context. We are going to divide these experiences into groups. TAM applied to students and TAM applied to teachers. The experiences with TAM applied to students can be divided in two big groups. TAM applied to classroom-based formal education, when we have experiences in secondary and primary, and overall in higher education. We also have another group, which is TAM applied in e-learning and e-learning context, when we have found experiences in higher education and related learning. The TAM applied to teachers can be divided in two groups also. TAM with preservice teachers, that tries to estimate the future acceptance of the devices by the teachers once they are in service. And the, although this is an assumption that is in question, and TAM with in-service teaching, that is becoming more important due to the fundamental role that the teachers play in the process of integration of ideas. We have some interesting researches in Spain, although the application of TAM model in Spain is still in a primary stage of development. We can find experiences in higher education and life of learning, focus on the students. After performing a exhaustive literature review, we selected for our model, for an extended TAM model to measure mobile acceptance, five concept model theories that has been tested in the field and given good results. The first construct is the previous experience, which is considered by some authors as one of the most recent modelated factors, but lack of an equivocus definition. In our model, this is defined as the previous experience coincided with the technologies in the daily life. The second one is the perceived enjoyment, which comes from the motivational model of technology behavior, proposed by Davis, which activity of using the technology is perceived as enjoyable regardless of the consequences of the performance that can be anticipated. The third one is the subjective norm, that we have explained before. And the fourth one is the self-efficacy, that comes from the social cognitive theory of Bandura, and designates the assessment that a person makes about their own ability to adequately use the devices. The last construct is the facilitating condition, that comes from the Utah Oath, and measures the perception of the individual of the resources at his disposal in order to support the behavior. We originally planted this scheme of relationship where over five contexts related with perceived usefulness and perceived ease of use, and the rest of the scheme is the model proposed by Davis. But after a deep revision of the relationship, we came with this other model where we maintain over five linear constructs and the relationship with perceived usefulness and perceived ease of use. We eliminated the concept of attitude toward the use, which is a recommendation made by the author in order to increase the behavioral intention of use, and we link the previous experiences, the enjoyment the facilitating condition and the subjective norm with the behavior annotations in order to increase the explanation of bias. We have built an instrument divided into sections, one for the identification data of the participants, and the other is composed by a Likert type scale to measure the construct. This instrument is currently being validated, and after the validation is finished, we will use it to perform a study of the acceptance of mobile technology by the primary education teachers of SDA. In conclusion, I would like to say that techno learning is a methodological alternative, traditionally situated within the formal field, informal field of education, that is starting to be related to formal field. And the teachers play a big part in the integration of this methodology, and we believe that our proposal that consists in a theoretical model elaborated as thesis literature review can serve to explain the teacher's adoption of mobile technologies. So, thank you for your attention. Any questions?